Hi, it's Burnett. Welcome to the first episode of the Basement Tapes, possibly the last. This is an interview with Marc Johnson. I recorded it on February 21st, 2020, and it ran in the May 2020 issue. This was supposed to be for one of those The Year I Got SOTY articles, but then once I finally got him on the phone, Marc ended up talking for over 2 hours, and I realized we needed to expand this thing into a bigger piece. I had no intention of putting this out, so you'll notice the audio is completely, totally terrible. But I thought maybe there's a few maniacs out there who would want to listen to 2.5 hours of unedited Marc Johnson. So now is your chance. The pride of Winston-Salem, North Carolina, our 2007 Skater of the Year. The elusive, mysterious, confounding, but never, ever boring, Mr. Marc Johnson. Thanks, Marc. Okay, so this is The Year I Got SOTY, 2007. Can you believe it's been 13 years?
No, man. It feels like 2 years ago. Fucking time goes by so fast now, it's freaky.
So you, leading up to your receiving the SOTY award, you had been on a 4-year intensive training boot camp to make this video. Well, take us back to that time. What was that experience like? What are your memories of that experience?
It started out, I want to say, if you watch the end of, what fucking video was it? There's like the end, I don't know, there was the end of a video before that, people are talking about keeping it going or something like that. So it started like in 2003, it started the way that other videos start. It was just really relaxed and really, really mellow and normal, like how videos kind of were back then.
Mm-hmm.
And then I don't know what happened behind the scenes. I have no knowledge. I have no nothing. I didn't know anything of what happened behind the scenes. But little by little, it got more and more intensive, and the trips. You know, the trips were more frequent, and the pace was more frenetic. And then it was like, I'm not gonna say pressure at first. It was just little things that you would notice, like the conditions and the environment got more. I don't know if I can find the word to describe it. Like the conditions of these trips and the vibe, like the environment, it got more and more intense. And then you could kind of notice that there would be like infighting, like people. You know, it just got to be where certain people were not talking or not dealing with other people, and live more and more like, you know, there's people who literally dropped out, like Danny Garcia. I just saw him the other day. I think Danny got a taste of the when it got intense, and he just fucking left.
Yeah.
And I fucking respect him for that. I seriously respected him for that, because he was just like, I'm not into this, like, goodbye. You know? Well, and then there were guys like Papalardo who did not like, he kind of felt it and saw it and realized pretty quickly that he wanted nothing to do with it. And so he stayed in New York and he filmed what he wanted on his own time.
Well, you know, to put it in historical context in skateboarding, this is coming off of those, a really, you know, insane a time in skate video history. You know, you'd had You'd had those Trans World videos. You'd had the Zero saga. You'd had the Flip sagas, and you'd had these videos that where it got to where people were, you know, this was the era of lighting it up at night. And then you guys were working with Ty, who kind of pioneered this whole thing of this like intense intensity. What was it like working with him?
Well, you know, to Ty, I think Ty was, he kind of, you know, when he, I think starting with Silver and Genesis, Ty started to pioneer a lot of stuff. Like Genesis came out, it was like a lot of electro music, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I think a lot of people weren't expecting that, and the skating was gnarly, and like Genesis was a fucking great video, and then Silver had a story, like Silver had continuity to it, if you remember.
Mm-hmm.
Those guys all finding and pitching that Silver Dollar.
Mm-hmm.
So everybody had it had this flow, this continuity, and I think Ty pioneered like stuff like that. It was just fucking cool. And then working with Ty on Modus Operandi was fucking phenomenal. It was great. It was fucking great. It was fun. I'd go down to Hollywood and stay with him, and we'd just go skate. And it was fun. It was super fun. And then working with him a little bit on Yeah Right, because I came in at the very end of Yeah Right.
Uh huh.
So like getting to kind of hang with those guys. While they were doing Yeah Right, even before I skated for Chocolate, that was fun because I already had a relationship with Ty, so you know he was one of my dudes, anyways. But for Fully Flared, so we did Hot Chocolate. Hot Chocolate was cool; just a month on the road, and that was easy and fun. And then for Fully Flared, it's like I said, it started out normal, and we had already been lighting shit up. Like we had been lighting shit up since Modus Operandi with Greg and Ty.
Mm-hmm.
So lighting stuff up and skating all night, like that was no big deal. And everything started out normal enough and really mellow. And like I said, like at some point the vibe changed, and I'm not privy to that information. I'm not privy to why it changed, but everybody noticed that it took there was a lot of pressure, and it was almost like an unspoken pressure.
Yeah.
A lot of pressure, and it took on a kind of like a, like a lot of people were just unhappy.
Huh.
And you could tell, like a lot of people were unhappy, and a lot of people were not enjoying what they were doing, but we were all together, and we were working on this project, so we just fucking did it anyways, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, there's a long history of unpleasant hard work that results in spectacular projects, you know?
Yeah, and I think eventually they kind of figured out a formula.
You know? Uh-huh.
Like, okay, to get the best, to get what we want and what we know these guys are capable of, what we have to do is we have to get these guys all together, and we have to facilitate, you know, we have to take them to spots, and we have to, you know, because this is what I eventually realized about Ty, you know, like I feel like a lot of people kind of put Ty in the crosshairs, I think a lot of things were sort of dumped on him, and he was put in the crosshairs for how gnarly it got. But I honestly believe that it's not because of Ty that it got gnarly. I'm pretty sure that something happened behind the scenes that really kind of broke his heart, and he just said, "Fuck it, I'm gonna make Apocalypse now." You know, you'd have to talk to him about that. I'm not trying to air anybody's laundry, but
yeah.
Like something changed with Ty, and I don't know what it is.
Uh huh.
I have an idea of what it is, and I think something broke his heart, and then he just was like, "Colonel Kurtz, like I do not give a fuck. Let's go."
Yeah.
So the formula, if I remember correctly, the formula was, let's go on the road, let's go to this foreign country, we're gonna fucking set up camp in these apartments or, you know, Motel 6s or whatever, and we're just gonna get up in the morning and we're gonna go skate. And we're not gonna stop until every single person, like, on the team is absolutely fucking done. If one person wants one trick at any fucking spot, we're going to stay out all night. Nobody could go back to the hotel. Like, Uber didn't exist back then. we were out until 6, you know, 5, 6, 7, 8 a.m. sometimes, because one person wanted a trick at a spot.
Yeah.
And that was the formula. It's like, get these dudes, take them to spots, and we're not calling it until every last person has, anything they want. Like, anything they want, anywhere they want, we're fucking going. So basically, while Ty ended up in the crosshairs, and I think a lot of people just did not know what was going on behind the scenes, so, you know, he's such a fucking workaholic. Basically, I realized after the fact that all Ty was doing was giving us the opportunity over and over and over and over. All he did was give us the opportunity to realize our true potential.
Well, for you, what was an intense high of that experience, and what was an intense low?
An intense. One thing in particular, and like an intense high would be like working on a trick for a long time, you know, and getting it, because a lot of that stuff wasn't planned. Like, we would go to strange cities that we had never been to, and we would just go to spots we had never been to, and we had to figure out those spots while we were there because we weren't coming back.
Yeah.
You know, so if you went to a strange city that you'd never been to, and you went to a fucking really cool spot, and you're just skating it, and you're looking at it, and you're like, I think I could make on this spot, I think I could maybe do this trick. And you got to start trying it and figure it out and land it, because you're not coming back.
Yeah.
So some of the intense highs would be just like going to a spot I'd never been to and doing a trick I had never done before. Like, just one shot, one kill. You know what I mean? Like, for example, there was a trick in Fully Flared. It's at the Milan train station, the Milano Centrale, you know, those ledges, the marble ones. So I'd always, when I would watch Plan B Questionable, this trick of Danny Wade kind of just went by. Like, it just went by. This part is like 7 minutes long of just fucking gnar. And there was this trick that always fascinated me that Danny did, and it was these ledges under an awning, I think, in San Diego. And he does a frontside board slide on a ledge, and it turns around to a nose blunt slide and pops out the middle.
Uh-huh.
And that trick, for some odd reason, that trick always fascinated me.
I think that's at Rencon before they built the rails.
Oh, really? Like, remember everybody? Like, Eric skated them. Like, everybody skated
them. I think that's Rencon. I think Rencon, there was a time when it was just the ledges before they put the rails in, and people just skated the high ledge. I think. I could be wrong, though. But I know what you're talking about.
Yeah. It was like it was almost like bleachers, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, Danny did that trick, and for some odd reason, that one always stuck in my head. There's certain tricks and certain video parts that always stuck out to me. Like, a lot of stuff Henry Sanchez did.
Yeah.
Just really obscure shit that, like, nobody else ever did after that, you know? And Danny's trick, nobody ever did that. Like, after him, nobody went and did that shit. Like, front board, bat, like, nollie into a nose blunt slide, pop out. So we were at the train station, and I was playing with, like, frontside board slide to fakie, like, trying to almost, like, get a little switch ollie out fakie, you know? Like, all these weird board slide tricks. And I started messing with that trick, and I was getting them, you know what I mean? And I filmed one, and I was like, oh, my God. That was like, just remember that feeling of like, and I was playing with it at Machba on that little tiny ledge that's at the bottom that has the little ramp going down.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just dorking around with it. Like, I think I was with Kenny Anderson or something, just playing with it. And I was just like, I can get into this shit. Like, I can fucking probably do this. And then we went to Italy, and I got that trick. And I remember just being so elated, just so, just like, oh my God, I learned a new trick that I'd never done before. And it was like one of my favorite tricks out of all the videos I'd ever seen.
Yeah.
That was insane. And then there was that trick in, I think it was in Atlanta, on the roof of that, like, parking structure with that weird tin ledge with the angle iron in the middle.
Yeah.
Like, switch nose one slide to backside nose one slide over the angle
iron. Yeah, yeah.
Rolling away from that was just like, oh my God, dude, that, because it was very, very hard to do. That trick was really, really hard to do for some odd reason. Like, just all this weird shit kept happening. So rolling away from that was just, it felt so good. And that, we were like in the, we were in, by that time, that was 2007, that was summer 2007. So the intense period of that video had been going on for years at this point.
Yeah.
You know, so I remember rolling away from that trick, and I went to the wall at the very end of the parking lot, and I got on my hands and knees, and I just, like, I put my head into the wall. Like, it was just like endorphins and gratitude and relief and all that stuff. And that particular feeling, that feeling was amazing. That was such a good feeling.
That's rad.
Yeah, so that was that. It was moments like that, and there were plenty of them. Like, just, I mean, you know, because that was the era where every video, every consecutive video part you had to be better than your last one.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So for this, for Fully Flared, I had to go out and learn a shitload of new tricks. You know what I mean? So there was tons of those highs, man. That's what, you know, that especially, like, it kept me and Guy Mariano, it kept us going. Just the constant need to get something that day, like, you know, we have to get something today so we can keep going. You know what I mean? Because I think some people, little by little, I think some people who weren't feeling that, you know, like, maybe they weren't on that same, like, extremely obsessive, addictive fucking thing that Guy and I were on. I think there was, like, I think a lot of people sort of maybe lost interest in the video or filming for it or something. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
But, that shit, like, the obsessive, compulsive need to always get a new trick, that kept us going to the very end.
Yeah. You know? I was going to add...
I'll tell you, here's one of the lows. There were plenty of lows. There were plenty of lows during that time, too, because that's when I was drinking a lot. You know, so even though we were filming and I was getting a lot of footage, I was also drinking a lot at that time, which made my personal interactions during that time were extremely turbulent.
Yeah.
You know, like, my relationship with Ty became extremely turbulent. Like, my relationship with Kelly Bird completely fell apart. Like, I got in a fight with Cairo Foster in Russia. And this is just these guys calling me out. Like, Eric called me out, like, in Arizona on a trip. Like, Eric just called me out. You know, and he was just, because I was just wiling out, you know, like, I was just being extremely irresponsible.
Yeah, yeah.
And Kelly Bird called me out because I was being extremely irresponsible, and Ty would call me out because I was being extremely irresponsible. So, in my mind, I justified my behavior with, you know, hey, I'm getting clips.
Right. Right.
Like, I'm getting clips. Like, what's the problem? I'm getting tricks. What's the problem? And I was just too fucking young and too young and selfish and ignorant to realize that my behavior was actually affecting other people in a negative way. I couldn't see it at the time.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, it's just a combination of being young and having no tool. Like, I didn't have a skill set to to cope with the pressure. I had no tools that I had in my bag to cope with the type of pressure that we eventually ended up under.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, and young skateboarders generally don't have a lot of coping skills.
Right.
You know, like, dudes would either, like, bail out. They would either not go on trips at all. They would bail out early. Or if people stayed on the trips, they were coping with the environment and coping with the vibe in various ways. And the way that I used to cope with it is I would just, like, stay fucking on a steady buzz.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So, well, I remember specifically one of the lows was, it was, so we rented, I want to say it was 2004. I'll tell you two of the lows. Horrible stories. So we rented these apartments. It might have been our first trip to Spain, or maybe the second trip to Spain, 2004, 2005, something like that. And we had two or three apartments in Barcelona. And Tony Cox and Brad Staba, I think Brad was on that trip, and I think he was staying in our apartment. It was like me, Beeble, Brad, Jesus Fernandez, and I know Tony Cox was visiting a lot because he lived up there at the time. But there was a night where we were fucking drinking and blah, 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 and Brad used to do this thing where he would cut people's heads out of one magazine and glue them onto somebody else's body in another magazine and make these, like, really funny, you know, these skate magazines.
Yeah.
And so we had a magazine, you know, I don't remember what it was. We had a magazine, and this is when magazines were fucking huge, like 250 pages. So we had this magazine, and Staba lit it on fire in our apartment. Lit the fucking magazine on fire, and I'm sitting in a chair. I'm drunk. I'm sitting in a chair, and I think Brad had ripped my shirt off, and there was like shreds left on me. And I have shreds of a t-shirt on. I've got a black eye from burning a wine cork and wiping it on my eye. And Staba hands me a burning magazine, and somebody shoots a photo of it. Right? somebody shoots a photo of me in our apartment, holding a burning magazine, and the fucking thing was fucking burning. Like, it was crazy. So in the morning, you know, mind you, Staba lit the fucking thing on fire and then basically threw it on me. And so I'm holding it up. It's burning. Somebody shot a photo of it. In the morning, there's burnt magazine ashes fucking everywhere. Right? We just put it on the tile floor and let the fucking thing burn. You know what I mean? So in the morning, Kelly Bird comes to our apartment, and somebody went over to their apartment to show him the photo of me holding a burning magazine. Then he comes over to our apartment. He sees the fucking, he just sees the, just the, you know, the rubble from the destruction. There's wine bottles everywhere. Just fucking shit, like burnt magazine pages. We might have lit a bunch of other magazines on fire. I can't remember. So there's just shit all over the apartment, and the company is paying for it, right? So Bird just fucking starts going off on me. He's like, I saw that photo, you fucking burning magazines in here. And I was like, Bird, that was not me. Staba lit the fucking thing and threw it at me. And he didn't want to hear it. He just was coming after me.
Yeah. Right?
So then I go over to their apartment, and I'm, of course, a little drunk. I go over to their apartment and tried to fight Kelly.
Oh.
Just so retarded. Like I didn't fight him, but I was like, you know, just like, let's go outside right now, like that kind of dumb shit, you know. And I went to go, you know, basically, like, they calmed me down, and Kelly and I went outside, and basically he sat me down and he goes, look, dude, we're really worried about you. Like, we don't want anything bad to happen to you. So he sat me down, and he had a serious talk with me. It was the first time anyone had ever done that in my whole life.
Yeah.
You know, and he explained why that they were worried about me, and I think I was like 25 or 26 at this point. And he said, look, dude, like, what you're doing right now can easily result in death. Easily. We've seen it, you know, he's like, we've seen it before. Like, you can, like, trajectory right now. We're watching you on this trajectory. We're just worried about you, dude. Like, you were fucking out of control. You know, and it was weird, man. Like, no one had ever spoken to me like that, or no one had ever given a shit about me like that.
Yeah.
So, you know, like, it was, so that was a fucking low, that's like a low point in my whole life.
Yeah.
And then there was this, so basically, I want to say a year and a half later, we went to Russia on a trip, and I don't think we did any demos. I think it was a filming trip. It was like me, JB, Cairo, Carol, Rick, Ty, and I can't remember who else, but...
You know who else was there?
You were.
Me!
Yeah, you remember that fucking trip, right?
Yep. Definitely.
Dude, oh my God. So basically this is, and I'm going to say this in the, you know, for the magazine or whatever, this shit happened. So remember we had the Russian sort of, like, we had the driver, we had the tour guide guy and his girlfriend.
Yeah.
So the girlfriend, her father worked at the American consulate. The American embassy. So, let's say that we're about to fly to, I want to say we're about to fly to St. Petersburg. And before we hop in the van to drive to the airport, Marc thought it would be a great idea to get a bottle of vodka and drink it on the way to the airport. Now, mind you, I wasn't a vodka drinker at this point. I didn't drink vodka. Vodka was gnarly. I didn't drink vodka. But you can buy it at every newsstand on the street in Russia. So I bought a bottle of vodka, and I just started sipping it on the way to the airport. And dude, by the time I got to the airport, they said I tore a payphone off the wall, and they had to walk me through security and all this weird shit, and I couldn't stand up anymore. And basically, I think we got to St. Petersburg, the cops were waiting for me, and they threw me in jail. Do you remember that?
Yep,
they threw me in jail. I have no recollection of that. I was completely blacked out. I have no recollection of being in the airport, of being on the plane, of getting pulled off the plane in St. Petersburg, or going to jail. I have absolutely no recollection of that. So they told me that I went to jail, Russian jail, and then the tour guide's girlfriend called her dad at the embassy. They threatened somebody or paid somebody off. They got me out of jail. They got me to the hotel, and I woke up the next morning at the hotel. That's what I remember, waking up at the hotel. And I guess I had gotten in a fight with Cairo Foster. And so I wake up, and I don't know where I am. I woke up in a room alone in a hotel. I didn't know how I got there. I didn't know anything. I didn't know that I had been to jail. I had no fucking recollection. So I go downstairs, I buy orange juice, like, I'm fucking thirsty as fuck, like, I'm just so fucked, it's so disgusting. And then somebody comes to my room, Bird comes to my room and goes, pack your bags, you're going home. And I was like, what? He goes, we got you a ticket, you're going home, right now. So I packed my bags, they took me to the airport, and I flew home.
Yep.
Like, yeah, dude, and, like, I'm telling you, Mike, like, I was fucking horrified. When they told me what happened, I was so embarrassed and horrified, and I can't even tell you how bad I felt. I felt so bad.
Yeah.
Like, I got in a fight with Cairo Foster. Like, I love that dude. You know what I mean? And I think he called me out. It was like, something. And I think I said something to him. I don't even remember. I was blacked out. But when they filled me in and told me everything that had happened, I was so fucking... Like, I was so horrified. It was so terrible.
Yeah.
Just sitting on the plane that whole ride home, like, with a head full of, like, you just did this.
Yeah.
Like, this is what you just did. That is another low point of that. Oh, that's a low point of my entire life. That's a low point of that video experience. And, like, that's just, it's almost like it's like a, when I think back about that time and when I think back about those years and that time, it's like I don't even know that person.
Right.
None of it even makes sense. It's like a bad dream.
Yeah.
It's very, very, very strange. And you know, and the reason I'm so open and candid about that stuff is because, you know, I would hope that if even one person reading this interview, you know, I hope that one person will maybe choose something different if they're going through something crazy, or you know, maybe they're on that trajectory.
Mm-hmm.
I would hope that you know, those stories would just kind of maybe help even just one person.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, to make better choices, because it took a long time for me to fucking open my eyes and make a better choice for myself.
Yeah, I was not to glamorize it, but I always wondered this, especially after that trip. I'm pretty sure you were blacked out and you were still doing manuals. Like, at what point do you lose balance?
In the beginning of the trip when we were skating, remember the weather was horrible? It was, like, raining every day? Yeah, in the beginning we were skating. Like, I was just, like, having some beers. Like, I wasn't drinking anything hard. But then it fucking rained for almost 2 weeks straight. There was nothing to do. And, dude, you know, idle time, or idle hands are the devil's.
I don't mean to make light of it. I was just at the time I was like, whoa, he's hammered and he's doing manual tricks.
that weird, that museum spot with the gap to manual. I was pretty toasty. I remember that. Yeah. I was pretty toasty. It was, yeah. Jesus fucking Christ. Full, just in it, dude. Like just in it at that period of my life. And fuck. Oh God. It was just, I'm so embarrassed by that period of my life. I'm not kidding.
Well, you got on chocolate and you started working on this project. And then I assume that must have been that's when you got to know Guy, right? Like, cause you didn't know him from the early days. You were just a kid.
I didn't know him from the early days. I hung out with him one night. In Northampton after one of the Radlands contest days.
Mm-hmm.
Remember those contests?
Yeah.
So I think it was probably 97 or 98. All of those guys were there. It was the year Sheffy got fourth in that contest.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Sheffy fucking killed it. But it was that year that Sheffy just fucking did two of the most amazing runs. And I somehow bumped into Guy at the hotel bar or something, and then like he and I just randomly went out. Like we didn't even know each other.
Mm-hmm.
And he and I just went out to like a club or something and just hung out like for a while. And that was an odd thing. And then I bumped into him at these rails up in kind of deep up in the valley, those like turquoise rails, kind of low.
Yeah.
At that school. Fuck, what was it called? Like Eric did a bunch of crazy shit on it. Like, fuck. Anyways, we were there. I was there with Ty one in like 2000 or something like that. And Guy and Gabriel just showed up there randomly. So bumped into Guy there in 2000, and I didn't see him again until 2006. And I saw him. He like came on a trip.
Yeah.
He's like, what? It was sick. I heard he was skating again, and Retta told me. Retta was like, yo, I've been skating with Guy. Like, he's killing it. And I was like, shut the fuck up. Are you kidding me? Yeah. It was fucking amazing.
So what was your relationship like with him diving back into this project? Because I have to imagine that he was, I mean, like me, he was somewhat of a childhood hero of yours, right?
Oh, absolutely. Oh, yeah. From video days to the friends section in virtual reality to Mouse. Like, dude, serious obviously, oh my God. So after Mouse, he dipped out. He like broke out of skating for a while. Popped back up, I think in 2005, I think is when he popped back up, and I think he started going on trips in like late 2005, early 2006.
Uh-huh.
So yeah, I think we bonded pretty quickly, just over like kind of like some shared experiences, and we were the same age, and we had like all kinds of ideas for new tricks, and like that dude was a soldier. He is a soldier.
Mm-hmm.
So you get two really, really obsessive skateboarders together, and they're just gonna go to a spot and just work the shit out of it.
Yeah.
You know? So many times we'd go to spots and this has just happened like trip after trip after trip after trip. We'd go to spots and it would be me and Guy like last man standing.
Yeah, how does that affect you? Does it give you more energy to look over and know that you have a friend struggling?
Absolutely. So you're not. It's like this. It's like you know you've got somebody in your corner. You know you're in someone's corner. You've got somebody in your corner, and it's not like you're the only one holding the whole fucking team up from going to bed at a decent hour.
Because that was the pressure. As long as you're trying it, you're keeping Beeble awake.
Dude, I caused Guy to miss a flight one time because I was trying to trick for so long. Because we were all stuck at the school. Like, we were in a van stuck at this school in North Carolina, and I'm trying to trick, and Ty's like, dude, he's going to land this. Like, you can catch a later flight. I'm not kidding you. You know, so there were plenty of those times when like, you know, last man standing, and everybody's just like exhausted and just like, you know, and they're just over it and tired and done. And I'd be trying to trick, and like everybody's sitting around, and it sucks when, you know, you're lighting a spot up, it's 3 a.m, you're trying to trick, you're trying your hardest to get it so you can all go back to the hotel and get some sleep. And you're looking around at everybody, and you're just, you know that they're bummed. You know, and it's just like a whole, and then Ty's just like, fuck that shit, Marky. Do this shit. And Ty's like, fuck everybody sitting down right now. Fuck them. Do this trick. So, you know, like skating with Guy, like Guy would be right there. Like, a lot of times, like Guy would be last man standing, like trying some crazy trick at 3 a.m. Yeah, man. I mean, that's, you know, to fucking, dude, to get it done. It's like the old saying. It's like if you want something different, you have to do something different.
Yeah.
If you want something more in life, you have to do more in life.
Yeah.
So that's exactly what Ty was doing. You know, he wanted more, so we had to do more. Like, it's like, hey, if you want this thing to be fucking, if you want this video to be phenomenal, you have to go outside of your comfort zone and reach for something that you've never tried to reach for.
Yeah.
And that's what we did.
What kind of weird physicality was going on? Like, Aaron Mesa said he remembers you just eating the most gigantic fucking meals, like, in one sitting, because you're probably burning 20,000 calories a day. You're living like a, even now, you're a wiry fella, but at the time, what was going on physically with you, you know?
I don't know, dude. Like, honestly, you know who else told me that one time? Brian Anderson mentioned that to me one time. Brian's like, I've never seen a human being eat as much food as you do. Yeah, I don't know. We just go to a restaurant, and I would open a menu, and it would be like, sick, I'm going to get a chicken sandwich, and I'm going to get blueberry banana pancakes. Just like, I don't know what it was. It was like a weird thing at the time where I'd open a menu, and I'd be like, that looks good, and that looks good. I'm ordering all of it.
You're eating like a...
Dude, we were on a trip to Florida one year, and I ate almost a dozen donuts at a spot. Like, there was a Krispy Kreme, like one of those weird, like a, it was like a Krispy Kreme factory where you could see the donuts being made through this glass wall, and just walking distance from the spot. And I walked over there and I got 12 blueberry donuts and a coffee, and I fucking just started eating donuts. Oh, I ate so much sugary shit on that trip, dude. It was so, oh, I don't know, man, maybe, you know, it's just like fucking rocket fuel or something. I don't know.
Yeah,
I don't do that anymore. It's just, yeah, eventually that just faded away.
Well, you're just probably operating like a Iron Man athlete, you know?
Maybe.
You probably just needed that much fuel, you know?
But all the, you know, all the, you know, the beer during the day and the red wine at night, like, it was just consumption, dude. That's what it was. It was so much consumption, like compulsive consumption. Just like stuff as much shit into my body to distract myself from like how I feel.
Yeah.
You know, people, you know, there's all kind of, people have problems with eating and problems with shopping and problems with, you know, drinking or drug abuse or whatever. It's just like, you're just stuffing your feelings down. You know, you want to avoid your feelings, or you want to run away from your feelings. So I think I was just compulsively dumping shit in my body to avoid feeling anything at the time.
What were you trying to get away from? Was it your childhood? What was the deal?
Fuck, I don't know, dude. I don't know. Because it didn't start. Like, none of that shit started until we started filming Fully Flared.
Yeah.
Like, I always drank before then, but I didn't drink compulsively. You know, I didn't eat compulsively. I didn't really have an addictive personality or a compulsive nature until that video. Until we got going in that video. And then I just became a very compulsive person.
Well, most really good skaters have some compulsive tendencies, because that's what it takes to get that good.
Yeah, I think when I was younger, I would compulsively work, obsessive compulsive working on tricks. Like, I would just try a trick until I landed it.
Yeah.
I would rarely start working on a trick and just stop, rarely.
Yeah.
You know, so I think I pointed that obsessive compulsive nature in my early years. I just pointed it at skating, and then when you do that, generally you're rewarded for that kind of behavior. And then you grow out of that, and then you start pointing that obsessive compulsive behavior at destructive things, and you're fucking, dude, it's not very long. Your life will fall apart.
Yeah.
You know, but I didn't start drinking heavily at all. I was just like a social drinker, like super mellow, until we were like a year into filming Fully Flared. You know, it was, I don't really know why. Maybe it was just like the inability to cope with like how I felt at the time, or maybe the pressure. I don't know.
Well, I mean, you'd gone from North Carolina to on the same team with the fucking Plan B guys. You know, it's like, that must have been, even though you eased into it, that's got to freak everybody out, you know?
Oh, man, here's a weird one. So, you know, like, oddly enough, and I've mentioned this to someone before, I think, isn't it strange that, without trying at all, I ended up working with every single person that I looked up to as a child.
Yeah.
Like, you know, Steve Rocco, Rodney Mullen, just in the kind of in the world industries camp, like Daewon Song, Kareem Campbell, Shiloh Greathouse, like, you know, that squad. And then it was like all the Plan B and Blind guys, Rudy, Guy, Spike Jones. It's just fucking weird.
Yeah.
And I didn't I didn't maneuver that way. It just sort of, everything was happenstance. So one of the weird, surreal things that would happen a lot is we would all meet up at a spot. And it would be like Jason Dill, Gino, all of the, you know, Jason Dill, Gino, Carol, Rick, Guy, like some, you know, Rudy. And it was just like a trip to, it was like a trip to 1993. Just that happened a few times where I'd look around it and I'd be like, oh my God, like I'm in the middle of a 101 video here, or I'm in the middle of virtual reality, kind of. Very, very interesting how that happened.
Yeah, that's like being a kid and the next thing you know you're in the Beatles. It's a lot. I mean, I'm not pretending to know what your internal struggles were, but that's just a lot for anybody.
Oh yeah, man. Like I never grew out of that fan, you know, even, you know, being like 21, 22 years old, 23 years old, 24 years old, 25 years old. I'd be around people and I would just be fanning the fuck out. Like seriously, fanning fuck out. Like when I would see Rudy at Crail Town, I would just be, he didn't know, but I'd be fanning the fuck out. Gons, like I bumped into Gons because he did 4-star stuff for a while. I'd occasionally bump into Mark Gonzalez and I couldn't even open my mouth.
Yeah.
Yeah. At, you know, like at 29 years old, like, hey, Mark, what's up? Like, just mute, like. I never grew out of that. It's been, I think that's actually awesome.
What about, so while you're making this video, was the conversation of like, how's my part looking? Am I going to get last part? Was that part of the experience or not?
Never. No.
Cause it seems like
I never checked in. I was so checked. I was so checked out that I never checked in. You know, I didn't know shit about shit. I didn't know anything about, I gave Ty 3 songs. I was like, oh, these 3 songs right now are sick. I like any one of these songs. I really like.
So had you seen it before the premiere? So you showed up and it's like, it's the 3-song last part.
Yeah. Oh my God. It was that, talk about not being able to deal with that. That was really overwhelming. Yeah. No. Hell no. Ty wasn't going to let anybody see the video before the premiere.
Was there a point where you felt like I'm good, I'm done? Or were you just dying until the finish line?
I want to say the deadline to stop filming was probably mid-October. If the video came out November 16th, 2007, I believe the deadline was probably October 15th. I'm pretty sure it was right around there. I was done in August 2007 after our last U.S. trip. So we went to, in the summer of 2007, we went to Europe for a month, and then we went on the road for a month. And that trip, that U.S. trip in the summer of 2007, when I got home from that, I was fucking done.
Yeah.
Like, I was done. And dude, I didn't touch a skateboard again at all. I did not touch a skateboard again until January or February 2008, when I had to go to Texas to shoot the interview for the magazine. I'm telling you, Mike, I did not touch a skateboard. So when we landed in Texas to do this Texas trip to shoot a bunch of photos, I could barely skate. I mean, talk about a lackluster fucking showing in that issue. Oh, like, come on. God.
You're in the victory round. So what'd you do? How'd you go from that such an intense level of activity to, like, where'd that madness go? Where'd that intensity go? Because I'll be on, like, King of the Road for 2 weeks and get home, and I feel like a maniac because it's too slow.
No, I mean, dude, we did King of the Road in 2011. Remember the shit?
Yeah.
That shit was crazy.
So when you came off of 4 years of these crazy trips and then these month-long all-nighters, like, what'd you do? What happened? How'd you deal with being done?
You know, because I had spent so long being checked out, and when I was home, I was just like, it was like a steady checkout. You know, it wasn't crazy. I wasn't getting wild or anything. But I just checked out. I was like, I would say that I was decompressing. That's if anybody said anything to me, I'd be like, oh, dude, I'm just decompressing. And I would just hang out by myself and, you know, glass of red wine and just, I would just do my thing. And I didn't want to see anybody. I didn't want to talk to anybody. I just wanted to check out of the whole world. And I did that after that video. I did that until the end of, almost the end of 2009. So almost 2 years. I checked out for almost 2 years.
And you're up in the mountains?
I was like popping up here and there. But by that time, the drinking, it had its hooks in me, like physically. And that kind of lifestyle, like it had become just habitual.
Yeah.
So I had been doing it for so long that it almost became ingrained. It became ingrained in me, and I didn't like how I felt when I wasn't drinking. So I kind of kept a steady buzz. I kept a steady buzz for the next like year and a half, and I think maybe I don't know where the madness went. I don't know. Maybe. I don't fucking know. I don't know what I pointed it at.
You were up in the mountains, really? Right, this point.
I just got used to being up in the mountains by myself and just kind of... I don't even know. Fuck, I can't answer that question. I'm not sure. I just checked out. I mean, like, honestly and truly, I just stayed checked out for a long time. And I just got used to being checked out. That's all it was.
Yeah. What did it mean to you to get the Skater of the Year award?
Oh, dude, holy shit. Like, yeah, it was kind of incomprehensible. Because it's, you know, if it's happening to you, it's not the same as looking at one of your friends who gets it. Yeah. When you're like, oh my God, you're getting Skater of the Year. If it happens to you, it's almost not real.
Yeah.
You know, it's just kind of like, wait a minute, like, what the fuck? Like, there's only been 15 of these in history. Like, seriously, I think I got it, like, after 15, like, 17 or 18 or something like that. But
I think you're 18. The 18th.
Yeah, dude. And it's like, oh my God, there's only been 17 other human beings in history that's ever gotten this award. So it was very surreal and kind of overwhelming. Like, I didn't really know how to process it.
Yeah.
You know? And of course, at the time, I was definitely the kind of person at the time that was like, I don't deserve this. I don't deserve this. I don't deserve this. It's just kind of, yeah, it was, I used to do that with everything. Oh, no, I don't deserve that. I don't deserve that. If something good, I don't deserve anything good.
Is that why Retta kept your trophy?
Just put me in a van and take me to a spot so I can work.
Is that why Retta kept your trophy for so long?
You know what's funny is I don't know why Retta took it, but it's now it has grown into this huge joke. Because every time I talk to him, he goes, oh, I owe him a phone call, by the way. Every time I talk to him, he always says, somewhere in the conversation, he's like, yo, Mark, I got your Skater of the Year trophy. Like, you want this thing back or what? And I'll be like, no, I'm good. It really ties the room together, doesn't it? He's like, yeah, it goes with my rug. So now it's this huge joke. So he's got my Skater of the Year trophy, and I think he took it as a joke. Like, he took it from Mesa's office, and we were leaving crowds out, and he has it. He's like, yo, Mark, I've got your Skater of the Year trophy. What are you going to do about it? And I was like, nothing. Yeah, and it was this super fucking funny thing, and now it's like a thing. It's a huge joke. He's got my Skater of the Year trophy.
Dude, he kept hinting that he should be getting. He's like, "What about a photographer of the year? Right? Am I right? Yeah, you guys should give me that."
Yeah. He used to call himself the potty. The potty.
Yeah.
Yo, I'm the potty because he had Trans World Business used to. Do you remember seeing Trans World Business where they actually used to rank skateboarders?
Yeah, the exposure meter.
The exposure meter. So there was an issue where the I was number one in the exposure meter, and he was number one in the photography meter.
Yeah, it was your fully flared issue because you had 20 pages and he shot them all.
Oh man, and yeah, we were out somewhere one time, and he's like, "Yo, it's the soddy in the potty."
we're the seeds of your eventual breakup with. The Crail Camp, were they sowed during the process of making this video, or was it something else?
No, actually, not at all.
Yeah.
Not at all. That was 2007 when that video came out. That happened in the summer of 2013.
Yeah.
Was when I decided that I no longer wanted anything to do with those people.
Yeah. Is it sad? Is there pangs of hurt feelings when you think about like this? Because you had a time where you pretty much you gave it so much effort, and then it was with these group of people, and then now that those people aren't in your lives anymore, maybe some of them aren't. That's got to hurt a little bit, right?
No, it actually doesn't. You know, it did, because, you know, I was there from 2002 to 2016, 14 years.
Mm-hmm.
You know, 14 years is a long fucking time. To be around the same people, like, over and over and over, that's like, you know, like, at the time, it was like half a lifetime almost. So, that's all you know. You know, after 14 years, like, that's all you know. That's your world. That's all you fucking know.
Yeah.
But I think I had seen so much shit by the time that I had made up my mind that I just was just like done. I'd seen so much shit and I was so disgusted that I just didn't care anymore.
Yeah.
You know, this is the saddest part. This is the fucking saddest part of this. And this happened to a lot of us. By the time. Some people thought that it was okay to take a shit on the people that had built those companies. A bunch of us felt like we were stuck.
Yeah.
You know, and I've talked to a number of people who confirmed this. They're like, yeah, man, like when you're 38 years old, you're thinking, oh, I'm too old. Nobody's going to want me. I'm too old.
Well, that's...
Nobody's going to want a 38-year-old, 39-year-old skater on their team, so we're fucking stuck. That's how a bunch of us felt. Like, we're too old now. Nobody wants us. Like, we're stuck here.
Yeah.
I certainly felt like that. So there was literally a space of 3 years where I was like, fuck, I'm stuck.
Yeah.
Nobody's going to, like, seriously, that phrase keeps echoing my head. Nobody's gonna want me. Nobody wants me. I'm too old. I'm too old.
Yeah. That's a common feeling.
Dude, those 3 years, that was a fucking concept of your value, no concept of your fucking, no sense of self-worth, no concept of anything. Just thinking that that's it, you're old, nobody wants you, nobody cares anymore.
Yeah.
You know, and that happened to a bunch of us, and it was fucking sad. And, you know, eventually I realized that's not even remotely true.
Yeah.
You know, we do have value.
That's a pretty consistent feeling in all of skateboarding on and every level is that paranoia of being too old.
Yeah, I mean, because skateboarding is a it's an activity that worships youth.
For sure, it's
compulsive modernity. It's always like, who's the new kid? Who's the new kid? Who's the new kid? Who's the new kid? What's the new thing? What's the new thing? Who's the new kid?
Yeah.
You've been around for a long time, and like a crop of new kids come up and they're fucking killing it. And of course, skateboarding is gonna take its lens and move it over to these guys. You know, so you're just like, oh fuck, you know, like, ah, well, you know, I had a solid, it's just like, I remember thinking one day, like, dude, you had a solid 20-year run.
Yeah.
You had a solid 20-year run. Nobody cares about you anymore.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's just like, eh, well. some people get like a solid 2-year run.
Oh, man. I mean, that's a thing. And I commiserate with, because I deal with the last lingering pros who are my age. I deal with dudes who are skating their balls off, but the fickle hand of what's cool is not in their favor.
Yeah.
It's selling kids to other kids, and it's timing and luck, and it's not always about who's the best or who's the, you know, there's a lot of factors going on. So, but yeah, the progression in youth was the story for so long.
There's a group of us. There's a group of us that, like, Guy, Eric, myself, Gino, Day One, of course, Day One. There's a group of us that we just. I mean, I feel like we all work really hard. You know, we worked past tense, and we still work really hard. But for whatever reason, we have been extremely blessed to continue to matter to people.
Yeah.
Because how many people came and went in the 90s? How many people came and went? It's like, this guy pops up with a Wheels of Fortune in 401, and like a year later, nobody knows where he is.
Yeah.
You know, or this guy is in this magazine, or this guy has an interview, and like 2 years later, nobody knows where he is. And it's like, yeah, it's the fickle finger of fate. Like, who knows who makes the rules or why things are, but, you know, us being under the microscope for 20 years fucking straight is incredible.
Yeah.
It's fucking amazing, dude. Like, yeah.
Yeah. Well, how is your life different now than it was in 2007 when you got Skater of the Year? What are the main ways your life is different?
I'll answer that question by saying this. For 20 years, I got to be the exact same. I got to almost be the exact same person. And for 20 years, I was rewarded for being exactly who I was, good and bad. So there was nothing happened in my life that required me to change drastically. You know, didn't require me to change my personality or fix my problems or work on myself or look at myself or, you know, I got to live in this thing for 20 years where I could be whatever I wanted, I could do whatever I wanted, and I could completely ignore everything. I didn't need to change. I didn't need to make changes. And then in 2012, I lost my son in like a court battle. My son's mother and I, it's just, I'll just say, like, she took him away from me, and we started this legal battle for 2 years, and the lawyers, I had to pay for her lawyer, too. Mm-hmm. Eventually, the judge made me pay for her lawyer, but, dude, two lawyers for 2 years, it took everything from me. And it completely just broke me into a million pieces. And, I feel like I kind of dipped out. Like, I dipped out for a while. I wasn't really skating anymore because when you're going through some shit like that, like, the last thing you give a fuck about is riding a skateboard. The last thing that I was inspired to do was ride a skateboard. So I crumbled. I imploded. I curled in on myself and just fucking imploded. And, like, everything, all my hard work, everything I'd worked for was gone. In 2014, it was just fucking gone. And, I lost a good relationship because of that. And, I had a dog. I lost my dog because of that. Like, so by April or May of 2014, I literally had to start over. Like, I had to pick up the pieces and I had to really look at myself. Because what happened was during those 2 years, like, I didn't get to see my son for six fucking years. But during those 2 years that we were going through the legal battle, I had never been squeezed by life before. Mm-hmm. I just kind of had this, like, skater, sort of like a skater ride through life, a 20-year skater ride through life. Just like, oh, you got to go on tour. You got to go to this contest. You got to film a video. You got to go out with your friends. You got to hang out with your friends. You got to go to the bar. You got to hang out with your friends. You got to go skate with your friends. I got to do that for 20 years, and then for the first time ever in my life, I was fucking squeezed, dude. I was fucking squeezed. And the interesting thing is, when I was finally squeezed, something squeezed me in life, I did not like what came out. I did not like what came out. Because I realized that what came out of me when I was squeezed is what was always inside of me, that I never had to look at in those 20 years, because I could just go skate or go on a trip or get drunk or fucking go, go do this or go do that. Like, I never had to look at myself. And so during, after that court thing, I did not know who I was anymore. I lost my kid. I didn't know who I was. I lost everything that I worked so hard for. And for the first time, I just had to stop and look at, like, the person I had become little by little, sort of just the person that I had ended up as. And I fucking didn't like myself at all. I didn't like the way that I reacted to all this. I did not like the person that I had become. And, going through a really, really serious fucking rough time, it showed, it was like a mirror was being held up to my face. And I got to see, the way that I reacted to all of this stress and the way that I completely destroyed, my relationship with a very amazing woman at the time. I just fucking crumbled because nothing in my life had ever prepared me to go through 2 years of psycho legal shit.
Yeah.
Like, family, there's, like, legal shit and there's family law. Dude, family law is on a whole other level of scumbag shit.
Yeah.
Because they're manipulating you, and they're holding your kid up in front of you like a carrot on a stick.
Yeah.
Like that. Oh man, the lawyer, the other lawyer, not my lawyer. They were trying to get me to. They were trying to get little favors. Like, oh yeah, you can see your son under these conditions, but you gotta give me $2,000.
Yeah.
Oh, it was crazy. It was fucking crazy. It's some backdoor scumbag shit.
Yeah.
Happened. And that's literally that's one of the three worst things that ever happened in my life. There's three crazy things that happened in my life. That's one of them.
Yeah.
Like the shit that these fucking pieces of lawyers are such fucking scumbags. It's crazy. But so starting then, I had to just basically, I had to pick all of these pieces up and reconstruct a new person. You know, I had to reconstruct a better person, and I have been. And that's what's different about my life. Like, I started, you know, I started on this journey of sort of, I don't know what you'd call it, man. Like, I started on this journey of sort of like looking at myself and working on myself and just becoming a much better person.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that shit doesn't happen overnight, you know, like you, little by little, you uncover something and you clean it up, and you uncover something else and clean it up, and you uncover something else, you clean it up, and like little by little, like years go by, and you're just like, okay, I feel like I'm kind of starting to maybe understand life a little bit.
Yeah.
A little bit, you know? So the last like 5 or 6 years, I've spent a lot of time, just like, I mean, this, I don't know, that sounds stupid, but, like reading a lot of spiritual books and philosophy and different things, and going to professionals and, you know, talking to people. Like, I've bumped into some mystics and some Kabbalah healers. I've studied Kabbalah a little bit.
Wow.
I've just gone and met all of these different people and worked with all these like amazing people who helped me kind of pull my head out of my ass.
Yeah.
You know, and one of the cool side effects of doing that is you stop taking shit off of people.
Yeah.
You know, I took shit off of so many people for so long because I was that guy who was just grateful to be at the party.
Yeah.
No matter how successful I was, no matter how much whatever, no matter what, I always had this thing inside of me that's like, dude, you're lucky to even fucking be here. Shut the fuck up and try that trick for 5 hours.
Yeah.
I went through my whole life like that. And then, you know, at some point, I started to grow up and I started to look at things and be like, you know what? That's actually not okay. Fuck you.
Yeah.
You know, at 40, 39 years old, I actually learned to stand up for myself and say, actually, no, fuck you. Go fuck yourself.
Yeah.
And it just gets better and better every day. You know, like I've learned how to stay the fuck out of bullshit, not participate in bullshit, treat people really well, have a relationship where I respect and I love and I listen to another person. You know, I care for another person. Whereas before, I didn't do that. I just was always checked out.
Yeah.
So, yeah, little by little, I just started to sort of grow up and become responsible for, just take respons- responsibility for my actions and, you know, my words and my, you know, all that stuff. And yeah. I mean, dude, it only took 40 years.
Yeah. Well, you'd be surprised at people that never figure it out.
Oh, I'm sure, man. I'm glad. You know, what's funny is, I was talking to my son's mother, I want to say like recently, maybe a year ago, I was talking to her and I thanked her. Thanked her because she inadvertently, she did some shit that like just shattered me. And if that wouldn't have happened, who knows? I may have continued just to be the same selfish, irresponsible, fucking, you know, checked out.
Yeah.
Son of a bitch.
Are you able to stop drinking?
Yeah. Oh, dude, I stopped drinking in 2009.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. I mean, I've had drinks here and there since then. But no. I mean, as far as it being like a part of my life, no, 2009.
Yeah. That's great. Yeah. Congrats on that.
Yeah, dude. And it's the longer you do that, like, the longer you do that, it just, you get used to life and that's not a part of it. Like, you know, I don't go to bars. I don't fucking hang out with anybody that drinks. I look, there's a saying, it's like, if you hang out in the barbershop long enough, you will get a haircut. So I stay the fuck out of the barbershop.
What's your, it was a big deal when you got on Adidas. What are you doing over there? What's your plan over there? Because I know a lot of people are excited to see, what you're up to, and they just assume that it's going to come through that channel. Are we imagining things? But then you just started the board company, so now I don't know what to expect.
Yeah, well, the board company kind of, like, I wasn't planning on starting a board company. The opportunity to start a board company came out of nowhere. Literally, it just happened in a phone call, maybe 2 years ago or something like that. Just on the phone with someone, and there was an opportunity to start a board company, and I was just like, all right, you know, I wasn't doing anything board wise. I was getting boards from gym. I was getting crooked boards from gym, and then I was buying polar boards. So I wasn't doing anything on the board, you know, in the board thing. And I got a bunch of offers to start a company, to start a brand under these different distributions. Mm-hmm. You know, I talked to maybe like seven distributions, hit me up to do, and they hit me up to do a company. So it was like this distribution, like it just kind of all happened right around the same time, and I thought it was pretty strange. But with the exception of one distribution, the deals that they kind of like put in front of you, you know, the partnership agreement or whatever, mm-hmm. is fucking disgusting. Shockingly bad. Like, you're gonna work your ass off, we're gonna make the money.
So, yeah.
So I just was like, no. And I would, you know, if a distribution hit me up to do a brand, I would background check them. I would call people and be like, you went through there, like, what was it like? What are those people like? What's the deal like? What's the this? And I would just background check all the distributions. So I said no to all of them except one. And then one of them, it wasn't the right time for them. So we didn't do it. But the opportunity to do my own board brand, it came out of nowhere so randomly. And it was just like so sort of like off the cuff. I was like, yeah, all right. And then, came up with a name and just fucking, you know, just kind of, just want, you know, like winding down the, easing down the road, you know, just kind of learning about it.
Tell me about the name, because the name seems like it's a little tongue in cheek, but then it also seems like an unsellable name in some ways.
I think it's like, I came up with all these different names, because I'm always doodling and I'm always doodling in like a sketchbook or something. Like I'm always writing shit and like doodling and getting, you know, collecting images out of magazines or off the internet, whatever. I've just been doing that for so long that I had all these folders with all of this artwork that I had no intention of doing anything with. And I had been doing that for a long, long time. So when the opportunity to do my own board brand came up, it was almost like I kind of turned around and I was like, oh my God, I have a computer full of shit ready to go right now. You know, it's crazy. And I had like written all these words and phrases in a sketchbook. And I went back to that sketchbook and I was like, huh, let me look into this one. Let me look into this one, you know, call my trademark lawyer and be like, let me look into this one, this one, this one, this one. A lot of them, you know, somebody else has that company making cupcakes or somebody else has that company making headbands or something like that. So you can't run with it.
Yeah.
So I was one day, it was in like March or April of 2018. And those two words popped into my head, and they mean absolutely nothing. They literally mean nothing. So a company, so basically a skateboard company, it is a business, and it is a company. And then there's a difference between, instead of being business A&D company, it's business ampersand company, because the word A&D means something completely different than the symbol ampersand. And the meaning of the ampersand is why I chose that instead of A-N-D. And anybody reading this can look that up. It's a very interesting thing. So the craziest thing is when I thought of that name, I wrote it down and I called the harshest critic in skateboarding to run it by him. Bobby Puglia. So I called Bobby. So I had another name too. And Bobby warned me about that name. He goes, no. There's a guy in the UK with a such and such company. If you use that name, he's going to come after you, because they came after my friends who used that name for this other thing. And I was like, oh shit. I had another great name, but I didn't want this UK fucking guy to like come after me. He said for sure he would come after me. I was like, oh well, fuck it. What about this one, Bobby? And I told him, and he kind of like mulled it over a bit. And he goes, he really fucking liked it. And I was just like, really? Because Bobby will tell you like it is. He doesn't give a fuck. And Bobby liked it. And I was like, oh my God, dude. Like, okay. And we talked about it a bunch. And I was like, okay, I like this. Like, it means absolutely nothing. And I like the fact that it means nothing. It's so, you know, what's funny is later on, I realized that when I started skating, my favorite company was World Industries.
Which also means nothing.
World Industries means absolutely nothing.
But it's like sarcastic. It's the idea that they were like, you know, remember the icon that was like the little smokestack and stuff?
Yeah.
As if they're a factory? Yeah.
Yeah, like if you called your company Global Corporation.
Yeah.
It's just so nondescript and vague, and it doesn't fucking mean anything. And I really like the fact that business and company, it is what it is. You're like, oh, yeah, it's like, it's a skateboard company. It is a business. You know, it's a company and it's a business. It's a business and company. And then ampersand company also means the people that you're with, your friends, your crew, your company, the company you keep.
Yeah.
So it's a business and the company you keep. So that's, there's kind of like some layers in there. The more I thought about it, I was like, oh, that's cool. Just didn't plan it like that. I was just like, I thought it was great because it doesn't mean anything.
Yeah.
It's just so nondescript and abstract. You're like, what the fuck does that even mean? It's like, it's great because it doesn't mean anything.
Yeah.
I can make anything I want. I can make any product I want. And it fucking works. I could make dish soap. Business and company dish soap.
So what do you want to do with this? Is it a fun art project for you? Are you trying to beat NHS's margins? What's your motivation here?
I was told for a long time. So these people that I worked with, you know, these like trippy spiritual advisors, and like I have an astrologer that I would call once a year to check in and get like a, you know, like a thing. And there's this lady in Ojai that I would call and get these like four hour cardomancy readings. And like, so over the years, I bumped into these people and talked to these people, and everybody told me, you need to write more. You need to write more. You are going to make and sell something with your art and your writing. And I'm talking person after person after person after person. 2012, 2013, 2014, 2015, 2016. All these different people would tell me, they would do these weird readings. Like, I would get tarot card readings. I would go to see psychics and like whatever. these people told me over and over and over and over, you're going to make something and you're going to sell something, and you need to write more, and you need to do more art. And I didn't listen. I just kept doing my stupid shit, you know, like whatever the fuck I was doing at the time, which was not much. And then I started like drawing more and messing around with the computer and like writing a lot more and whatever. And sure enough, here we are. And I'm just basically, it's like somebody like unscrewed the cap on top of my head, and I'm just doping stuff out there. You know, there's no like real marketing plan, or there's no, you know what I mean, like it's just whatever I feel like doing that day, I just do it.
So, you know, so is there a business, do you have a CFO, is there somebody there, or is it you in a warehouse?
Dan Rogers. Dan Rogers. Headlock, the boiler.
The human headlock.
Dan Rogers, dude. That's my C everything O.
Okay, well, he's intense.
Yeah, I love it. He will tell you like it is and won't hold back. I fucking love that.
I've had to remind him several times I'm not ready for a physical relationship with him.
Headlock. That's why I call him Headlock.
Gary Headlock.
he is so unusual. And you know how skateboard industry people can be, like smarmy and backstabbing and, you know, glad handing, smile to your face and turn around and fucking put a knife in your back. Like, there's a lot of that in skateboarding.
Yeah.
Dan just tells people, look somebody in the eye and just fucking tell them it's the truth.
So let me ask you this.
I love it. I fucking love that dude.
Yeah, he's fun. He's only yelled at me twice this week. So let's talk team. Because, like, some people might have an idea that they know who you are, who you'd like to spend time with, who your friends are. Maybe they imagine a Pulio or a modern Pulio Cox situation, you know, a bunch of artsy guys sipping tea, doing watercolors or whatever when they're not assaulting the streets. But you have Olympic hopeful Deshaun Jordan. Tell me about that pick.
Well, he DM'd me.
I like it already.
He sent me a DM in November 2018, and I posted a photo of these samples. They weren't production, but they were samples. I posted a photo of these two graphics that I had made up. And he sent me a DM, and it was like November 2018, and he basically, he just said, like, he really liked those graphics. Just, that was it. He's like, those boards are sick. And didn't hear from him again for like a year.
Yeah.
And then a year later, in 2019, he sent me, I posted something and he sent me a DM. And he said, it was so easy and natural. He's like, hey dude, I love your graphics. Like, would you send me some boards? Like, I would love to check these boards out or whatever. And he was already writing bareback boards anyways. So it was just like, yeah, the boards are made of bareback, like whatever. So he was like, oh yeah, would you send me some boards? And I was like, of course. What do you ride? He's like, 8.25. And I was like, oh man, we got a great 8.25. So I sent him some boards. I sent him like 10 boards. And he really liked the shape. Like he liked everything about the shape and all that stuff. And then I just kept sending him boards.
And it just, and what's he like as a person? Is he a guy you like to hit the streets with?
Dude, he's, man, oh God, he is a fucking sweetheart. Like, he is such a fucking sweetheart. It's crazy to know some, to get to know him and know, like, kind of his backstory, like his childhood and his backstory. Because he kind of had a bit of a rocky introduction to skateboarding, to the industry, I mm-hmm. think. I think, from what I understand, it was kind of like a bit of a turbulent, rocky sort of introduction to skateboarding. And he's always been really quiet, and he stays in his lane, and he does his own thing. Like, he literally just, he's off doing his own thing, stays in his lane, and I think there's some people who created some misunderstandings about him.
Mm-hmm.
And this is from talking to a bunch of people now. Somebody in particular created a bunch of misunderstandings about him. And Deshaun never said anything about it, never badmouthed. He just stayed in his lane and he just stayed on his grind, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I got to know him and I was like, oh my God, like, people like you still exist? Like, somebody that good and talented at skateboarding and who's just, like, a nice person.
Yeah.
Like a genuinely nice person with a heart of gold. He's not jaded. He's not bitter. He's not angry. He's not mean. He's not a shithead. He's not dishonest. Like, he is a fucking great human being.
Yeah.
And I don't think he's never had an outlet or an avenue to show that. He's had a couple of sequences in magazines and that's it.
Yeah.
You know, I think he's had some stuff online, a couple of, you know, some footage online or something like that. I don't think he's had a full video part. Nobody even fucking really knows anything about him. And it's amazing. It's fucking amazing. Like, we just went to go shoot that murder recruit thing. And me asking him to do that, I was like, there's no fucking way this dude's going to be into this. You know? And then I told him the idea. I told him the idea. And he was fucking over the moon. He's like, I'm so down to do shit like that. I love that. And I was like, really? I was like, most people would be like, no. He's like, no. I love shit like that. And I was like, oh my God, great, because we're gonna be doing a lot of that.
Yeah, I was gonna ask. That's it started off creep on the creepy side, and maybe riding the line of especially, you know, now in the competition to see who can become the most offended. It definitely is some bait for that. What makes you want to do that kind of stuff and still do the creepy, weird stuff like the skateboarding we grew up with?
You know how that whole thing came about is, so what I do is I if I get an idea, like a rough idea for something, I write it down and I tape it to the wall. So I tape it to the wall where it's up there and I can kind of reference it and look at it and think about it and whatever. And the more I thought about it, the more, like, I would add little notes to it and little ideas to it and whatever. And it just kind of, the idea just came to me, just, like, broken up into pieces, you know? And it wasn't creepy. Like, seriously, it wasn't creepy at first. It wasn't me, like, in pink, juicy couture, velour sweatpants. It wasn't that at first. It was a completely different idea. And the more I started, like, the more I started like shaping it, the more I was like, oh my god, like what if this shit is just fucked up and creepy, and then the reveal is just a freeze frame of his face, but he's wearing a wig. Because I'm looking for a brunette, and Deshaun is a shaved head. The first idea was him wearing a long blonde wig.
God damn it!
I know. And then I brought this box of like wigs and disguises and all this crazy shit. I brought it to Griffith Park, and I was like, Deshaun, pick a wig, and he picked that wig. I was like, perfect, man. We're looking for a brunette. Nice.
Did you?
And it was so, dude. He was so cool about it. Like he was so happy. And he was so happy and open and willing to just have fun, and I was so hyped. I was like, rad. Because a lot of people are like really insecure and would not want to put themselves out there like that. which I would have to respect that, because not everybody's like into the same stuff. And I was so happy that he was so like he was genuinely joyful about. Like filming all this and do the reveal and just like we're shooting these scenes and we're just like rolling. It's like watching a playback, we're just fucking rolling, and it just came together so fucking perfect. And I was like, what? Nobody's gonna suspect that it's Deshaun, because you're looking for a brunette. Like you're probably thinking that I'm looking for like a woman or something.
Yep, that's exactly what I thought.
Yeah. I'm looking for a woman while I'm a creepy dude, and it's just like that was the whole thing. The punchline is the freeze frame with Deshaun's face wearing a wig. Oh, dude, that was so fun, Mike. It was so fun.
So can we expect more of this kind of relative discomfort?
Well, more fun stuff. I mean, I wouldn't say that it's. It will always be like, you know, me with smeared lipstick and a big ass knife in my hand. I just made the punchline funnier, I think. But yeah, I just always have ideas that I think like would be fun to do. Like if ever had the chance to do them, I just write stuff down. Like, oh, this could be fun if it's done the right way, or this could be fun if it's done the right way. So just more fun stuff. Yeah. Maybe some of it'll be creepy, I don't know.
With Deshaun as your teammate, and with him, obviously he just put out a really gnarly Thrasher interview in like 2 weeks. So he's got it on the streets, but what's your opinion about skateboarding in the Olympics?
I don't know too much about it. So I heard this one weird thing. I heard that the skaters aren't allowed to eat like energy bars or protein bars or something like that. Did you hear that?
No.
So they had a meeting in London. I think it was London. They had a meeting, and it was like a rider meeting. And they told the riders, like, you can't do cocaine. You can't take steroids. You can't drink, you can't, whatever, while you're taking your runs and whatever, while you're in the Olympics, like, you can't, no performance-enhancing stuff. And then they said, no energy bars. No protein bars, no energy bars. They literally, and I was like, what? Why? Why? It's something about maybe a fucking Met RX or something would be like a performance enhancer. I don't know. I thought that was strange. So I know that little bit, and then I know that there's a lot of hatred toward it, and I think that's because certain people haven't figured out how they're going to make money off of skateboarding being in the Olympics yet.
Yeah.
So when more people kind of figure it out and they can kind of like slime all over the Olympics, they'll be on board. You know, a lot of people will be like, oh, you know what, actually it's fucking sick, you know, whatever. But think about it like this. all right, say, you know, there's 15 people on the team or whatever. I was thinking about this one day. I was like, okay, say just Deshaun, for example. Imagine being in the Olympics for skateboarding. Like, imagine you're the person who gets to be in the fucking Olympics. That's like a once-in-a-lifetime thing. And imagine your family, like how proud they would be of you, and how that would be like a highlight of their life. Like, you know, my son or daughter is in the fucking Olympics. Like, on that level, for the family of the people skating in the Olympics, I think that's pretty fucking incredible, because that doesn't fucking happen to people.
Yeah.
You're like, oh, like, hey, my son was in the Olympics.
Yeah.
For skateboarding. Like, that's a pretty crazy thing. But I already made money off the Olympics. I was the first person to put Olympics boards out last year. The gold, the silver, and the bronze. I was the first person to make money off the Olympics. My job is done, sir.
What about just in general about, I mean, do you care for it? Are you going to tune in on NBC and watch and see these arbitrary numbers?
I am absolutely not going to tune in. It doesn't affect my life one bit. It doesn't make my life better, and it doesn't hurt my life or take away from my life whatsoever. It's none of my fucking business. Right. But I will say this. I truly believe that skateboarding being in the Olympics is going to create a completely separate industry.
Right.
There will be skateboarding that we know, and then countries are already starting to do it. Countries are building skate parks are popping up in other countries like fucking mushrooms.
Yeah.
And these countries are pulling kids. They're pulling kids like out of fucking gymnastics and out of ninja school and out of fucking unicycle training, and they're fucking being like, you're gonna be a skateboarder now. You're gonna be on the Olympic team. You hear anything about that?
Oh yeah, for sure. In Asia, for sure. In China.
Okay. Oh yeah. So all these countries are gonna treat skateboarding as just like gymnastics or shot put or fucking pole vaulting. So that's gonna create, it's gonna be a fork in the road where there's gonna be this like weird offshoot type of skateboarding that you're never gonna see in the magazines. You're never gonna see videos. It's gonna live in its own weird world that we're never gonna interact with. And I think out of that, I really truly believe that there will be a bunch of new companies that pop up that only cater to that type of physical activity.
Yeah, or just they don't. It's a rejection of skate culture. It's kind of like these YouTubers, you know.
And, oh yeah, absolutely. And it's like you couldn't. The YouTubers, like, you couldn't get in the traditional way, like everybody else had to get in.
Or you just don't like it. You think Thrasher is scummy and trashy. You don't like, you know, you want it. Why can't we all just?
And the fucking truth be told is they couldn't fucking get in the traditional way like everybody else had to. So they fucking started a YouTube channel. And they turn their friends pro and blah blah. That's the truth. I mean, and you know what? If anybody is successful from doing that, good for them.
Yeah,
you know, they found a way around the system, and fuck it. It doesn't affect my life. It doesn't hurt my life. It doesn't make my life better. It's none of my business. I don't give a fuck.
Yeah,
I don't care. But the truth be told, is they could not get in through the gatekeepers.
Yeah. Bunch of
that's
fucking dicks.
That's a fact. I'm not saying in a derogatory way. That is a fucking fact. You couldn't get in through the fucking front door, so you went down the street and you built a treehouse.
Yeah, you went straight to the kids. I'm with you on the Olympics. Like, I'm not mad at anybody who wants to do it. It just doesn't excite me particularly.
No, and it's not exciting.
It's not what I like about skateboarding, but like, I'm not going to tell anybody, you know, whatever, do what you want to do. Like, I'm not wild about Street League either, that, or X Games or anything, but like, it's not like I'm going to be mad. I don't think it's a moral failing to participate.
Absolutely not, man. You know, people out there like to fucking run their shitty mouths about some shit that they can't fucking do anyways. So everybody's got a goddamn opinion about an opportunity that they'll never get.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Like, I don't like this, and you didn't do this, and you didn't give me what I want. Fucking, I'm going to shit in my fucking diaper and wipe it all over the window of the internet. And fucking, man, fucking crybaby horseshit bullshit. And it's like, the reason these people complain and have something to bitch about, whatever, is because they're never going to get the opportunity anyways.
Yeah. Yeah.
So you give somebody the opportunity to do all this shit, watch them change their fucking story.
Exactly. Yeah. No.
Watch them change their fucking story immediately.
Yeah.
You know what a turncoat is?
Yeah.
Yeah. Fucking turncoat. Straight up. Oh, well, you know, actually, now that they've let me in, I actually think it's a great thing.
What do you want to do in skateboarding? Do you want to just have fun out there popping wheelies and catching crooked grinds? Do you want to challenge yourself to do more tricks? Where do you find what's your motivation moving forward? What do you want to do with skateboarding?
So, I've been doing this 21-day Deepak Chopra meditation program thing.
Uh-huh.
And part of it, they ask you, you have to create a separate, like a separate notebook for all of these writing exercises along with these meditations. And the other night, part of the writing assignment was, one of the questions was, what is your highest intention for your life? And I had to sit and think about that. And, you know, like, so the easiest way to answer that question is in two parts. Part one is I've worked really, really, really fucking hard in my life, right? My resume speaks for itself. Like, my resume speaks for itself. Like, I've done a lot of work in my life, and I've been so blessed to have these open doors to continue to do that work, because that work is right for me. This work is right for me, Mike. Mm-hmm. This is what I'm supposed to be doing. So, part two of that answer is that, what are you going to do with that? Are you just going to film another video part? Are you just going to film another video part? Are you just going to fucking, you know, take another trip around the merry-go-round? Especially in this day and age when, like, a video part is forgotten in 3 days. You know? Because it is. It's a revolving door. It's a merry-go-round. Like, unless you do something more or do something different, it's not going to change. Like, you got a video part due in fucking June. All right, you got a video part due in December. All right, you got a fucking due video part due. It's just a merry-go-round, and I'm not knocking the merry-go-round, and the people that are on the merry-go-round having a great time right now, it's their time.
Yeah.
It's their fucking time, and like, I hope they squeeze every fucking drop of fucking goodness out of the merry-go-round, because it gives you a lot of cool things. But eventually you get to a point in your life, you're like, wait a minute. Okay, so I've done 21 of these fucking things. 21. Oh my God. I need to do something more. I need to do something different. And that's not to say, like, I don't want to do video parts anymore or whatever, but with these open doors that I have and that I've been able to get in my life, you know, like Adidas, for example, that's an open door for me. So, with these open doors, and this board company is an open door for me. My highest, I wrote down the other night in my notebook that my highest ideal, I'll read it to you, dude. It's not very long. I'll read it to you. And this is to answer that question. So and this may sound hokey, but it's part of this, like, really spiritual fucking meditative thing. So, I want to say this. And this is to answer the, it's back here. Bear with me, sir.
No problem.
After that, I literally just wrote this thing down. Here we go. So, I just wrote this off the cuff. Basically, it says, my highest, let's see here. My highest aspiration in life is to use my gifts and talents to help and inspire others to live an extraordinary life, to live their best lives, and to follow their dreams. My intention is to serve others. My aspiration, my life can and will be used. My life can and will be an inspiration to other people who may come from hardship and abuse. I will inspire people to follow their dreams. Yeah, there's a little bit more, but that's essentially it. So basically, with these open doors that I have in skateboarding, I'm able to work on these projects. There's something else that I feel that I need to do, and it's I need to use these opportunities that I have, these gifts, these blessings that I have, and I can help to change, I can help to maybe teach younger skateboarders or younger people something.
Yeah.
With all of my experience and, you know, whatever. I can use all of my experience and I can use my resources to help others. I can, like, help change somebody's life.
Yeah.
You know, like, because there's a lot of kids out there that probably come from broken homes or come from hardship and abuse and whatever, and maybe there's nobody out there, like, telling them, you know, like, fucking, no matter what anybody says, go after your shit.
Yeah.
Like, go for it. Like, whatever it takes, go for it. Like, the universe will conspire with you to make your dreams come true, and that's true. You know, so that's what my hope is. Like, you know, like, moving forward, like, this, you know, this this abstract, nondescript named company, like, hopefully I can use the company to do great things for younger people.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that's my hope. I mean, that's what I feel called to do. It's not like, oh yeah, this season we're gonna make a fucking yellow and green colorway of the logo deck.
Yeah.
You know, and then we're just gonna hoard the money. We're just gonna hoard the money and stack money in a bank account. Whatever. Like, fuck that. Like, one of the projects that I already want to do is I was talking to someone on the phone the other night, and we found a website, like a foundation, that sells artwork done by kids that are in orphanages. Like, these paintings and these drawings. Mm-hmm. Holy shit. Oh my god, dude. Mike, there's phenomenal artwork.
Mm-hmm.
And they're done by orphans. And I was just like, oh my god, I have to contact this foundation, and I have to figure out how to do something with this, like, make boards, you know, make a board or two boards or three boards, like, every season, and give 100% of the proceeds back to that foundation or that child.
Yeah.
You know, that's number one. That's the first thing that I thought of. I was like, oh, that'd be amazing. I was just blown away by this artwork. I was like, oh yeah, boom, that's a cool project to do. So, like, stuff, you know, stuff like that. Like, we don't have to make tired ass bland products and become wealthy and just fucking do nothing for anybody else. I think it's important that all of us, those of us that have resources, that have opportunities, that have something in life that other people don't, we can take that something that we have and we can help other people. We can share something with other people that maybe change one person's life or 10 people's lives. If you do that, your fucking work is done. Your job is done. That's it. Like, that's your purpose in life.
Yeah.
Like, we're not here to serve ourselves and, you know, until we're fucking 6 feet under. What a worthless, pointless life that is. And there was a lot of that in skateboarding. Those motherfuckers are almost all gone, but look, I mean, you know, a lot of companies got rich. A lot of companies, fucking company owners got really rich really fast when the fucking X Games popped up in the mid to late 90s, and then Tony Hawk released that game. And those kids came out of nowhere, like just a whole generation of skaters was created because of that video game.
Mm-hmm.
And then anybody who happened to have a company at that time, suddenly they were fucking wealthy. It's like, you're not a good business person. You're not a good businessman. You were just there at the right place when this sudden windfall income landed in your lap and you became super successful. How many of those people that ran these crazy huge companies in the late 90s and early 2000s, how many of those people did anything for skateboarding or gave anything back? How many of them did? You can count them on one hand and you probably won't make it through all the fingers.
How do you enjoy skateboarding now? What's fun for you?
Switch stance.
On the board.
Yeah. I don't know, dude. I just skate, man. You know.
Where do you go? Where's your spot?
It's fun for me. Okay, so it's fun. So I just turned 43. It's fun for me to go skate and, like, sometimes it's like, okay, I'm going to see if I can do this trick again. And it'll be like a trick I used to do or did, like, you know, when I was 18 or 19 or whatever. Like, sometimes I'll be like, I wonder if I can still do this. You know, or, and then learning, you know, like learning a new trick at 42, learning new tricks. There's no feeling like that.
Yeah.
That's still the best feeling in life. So like, there'll be days where I go skate, and I'll just be skating. I'll just do tricks, because I know how to do tricks. I'll just do tricks and just be like, holy shit, man, like, you're 42. This is, like, it's amazing that you can still do this shit. It's amazing. I think I've gotten to a place in my life where I just feel a lot of fucking gratitude for a lot of things.
Who's your favorite skater?
Like one person. Dude, there's so many for so many different reasons.
Who do you really admire across the board for what they've the person they are and what they've done with skateboarding? Who are some people that you really admire?
Roddy Mullen, Tony Hawk. I love that Dill almost died, and he pulled himself out of New York, and he grew FA into this, like, super successful thing. Dill did that, you know, with like his people.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty amazing to me. That's pretty admirable, because Dill almost died.
Yeah.
You know? So, for Jason to be where he was in, like, 2010, to where he is now, it's phenomenal. It's fucking phenomenal. I love it. able to do that. So I really admire the fact that he like switched some stuff up, and he pointed his nature. He pointed it at something really productive, and look what happened.
Yeah.
Let's see. Who do I admire? Oh man, I'm drawing a blank. There's so many people that are just so fucking nice. Solomon, I love Solomon Agape.
We tend to like. We make up just even as kids, we made up stories about what the Bones Brigade was like together. And I know people have made up these ideas in their minds based on who you've been in videos with. But really, what's your relationship with Louie and Jerry like now?
I don't, you know, I mean, technically, like, we don't have a relationship. Technically, mm-hmm. I'll talk to Jerry like once a year. I'll call him up and we'll just shoot the shit. You know, Jerry's just doing, he's busy doing his own thing with a completely different social group. Yeah. And Louie is busy doing his thing with a completely different social group in a completely different city. So it's like everybody's busy doing their thing, and like, it, you know, both of those guys are like, it's interesting. Both of those guys are kind of like doing their own thing, like doing things.
Yeah, you for know, sure.
That's awesome. I saw Louis last year, exactly a year ago. I hung out with Louis all night at Cairo Foster's party. Like, they had like a little, kind of like a quote unquote retirement party.
Uh huh.
And I hung out with Louie and all those guys all night, and that was rad. And then I talked to Jerry. Fuck, I don't know when I talked to Jerry. Right around the same time, actually. I think I talked to Jerry right around that same time for, like, maybe an hour or two. Actually, twice. I think twice, kind of back-to-back. And he was just telling me about, sci-fi fantasy and, what he was doing with that, and like how that started and everything. And I don't know. I just bump into people, check in with them. We're on great terms.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, yeah, I just don't, I don't get to see them or talk to them as much as we used to.
Yeah. You know, it's just, you know how it is. It's like you're bound in people's minds. And so it's always interesting to see like what the reality is, you know?
I mean, I think that's cool. I think that's actually really cool. Those are some good, solid people to be bound to.
It's become very apparent to me after this awesome conversation that we should probably get a few new photos for this and throw more pages at this thing. Let's talk about it.
Oh, dude, that would be fucking awesome. I haven't had a photo in mag for like 10 years.
All right. Well, here it is. I'm pressing stop, and we're going to talk about how we're going to get this photo. All right. I'm pressing stop.